Thank you. I missed the last couple of weeks, I've been fired.
Never.
Today at 3 o'clock, William Pittman gets his Eagle Scout Award, and he tells me that the ceremony is in the gymnasium at Concordia and not in the sanctuary. So if you were to go to the sanctuary, you're out of luck. Okay, anyway, it's at the gymnasium, which of course is in their school building, which is across the street. Senior Friends is Tuesday the 11th, and any other special word about that, Carol?
Reading from Zechariah, the 9th chapter. Rejoice greatly, O daughter Zion. Shout aloud, O daughter Jerusalem. Lo, your king comes to you. Triumphant and victorious is he, humble and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. He will cut off the chariot from Ephraim and the war horse from Jerusalem, and the battle bow shall be cut off, and he shall command peace to the nations. His dominion shall be from sea to sea, and from the river to the ends of the earth. As for you also, because of the blood of my covenant with you, I will set your prisoners free from the waterless pit. Return to your stronghold, O prisoners of hope. Today I declare that I will restore to you double. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
We will read responsibly Psalm 145. The Lord is gracious and full of compassion, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love.
Lord, you are good to all, and your compassion is over all your works.
All your works shall praise you, O Lord, and your faithful ones shall bless you.
They shall tell the glory of your kingdom and speak of your power.
That all people may know of your power and the glorious splendor of your kingdom.
Your kingdom is everlasting.
lifts up those who are bowed down. Second reading is from Romans, the 7th chapter. I do not understand my own actions, for I do not do what I want, but I do the very thing I hate. Now if I do what I do not want, I agree that the law is good. But in fact, it is no longer I that do it, but sin that dwells within me. For I know that nothing good dwells within me, that is, in my flesh. I can will what is right, but I cannot do it. For I do not do the good I want, but the evil I do not want is what I do. Now if I do what I do not want, it is no longer that I do it, but sin that dwells within me. So I find it to be a law that when I want to do what is good, evil lies close at hand. For I delight in the law of the God in my utmost self, but I see in my members another law at war with the law of my mind, making me captive to the law of sin that dwells in my members. Wretched man that I am, who will rescue me from this body of death? Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God. Identify with. Do you know of a
person in your acquaintance or life for whom, if the sky was blue and the temperature was 74 degrees and the humidity was maybe 40% or less, do you know a person who would say, "Oh, I hate this weather," or "What a horrible day it is"? There are some people, I think, that you just can't please. And that's what Jesus was talking about this morning. He was talking about the messengers that God has sent and how people receive them or not. He talked about John the Baptist, who came as a very ascetic man, who did not eat much and certainly did not drink any alcohol, and he lived out in the desert and he didn't have very many clothes, and he spoke a message from God, calling people to repent and telling them that the Messiah was on his way imminently. And because of the way he looked and the way he acted, the religious authorities, particularly the scribes and the Pharisees and all the muckety-mucks like me, they said he must have a demon because of his appearance, and the message that he was giving just did not go along with what they thought a messenger from God would be like. And then along comes Jesus, who dresses in fairly normal clothes, but he does enjoy a good party, and he does turn water into wine, and he drinks it, and he does sit down to eat with tax collectors and sinners, and the religious authorities can't accept that he is God's son or a messenger from God or anything else because of what he does, which is pretty much the opposite of what John the Baptist did. So Jesus says, can't please anybody anytime. With what shall I compare this generation? It's like children. Children who are sitting and playing and saying to others, "We played music for you and you didn't dance. And so instead of making happy, we made sad and said we wailed and you did not mourn." Can't please anybody at all, Jesus says. And then he says something a little bit enigmatic. He says, wisdom will be vindicated by her deeds. This whole passage, Jesus is alluding to wisdom literature quite a bit. And the whole passage at the end, "Come to me, you who are heavy laden," that comes almost directly out of one of the non-biblical wisdom books. But we'll get there eventually, maybe. Jesus says, wisdom will be vindicated by her deeds. God's wisdom will be vindicated by God's deeds. Jesus then says thank you to God steps on the Sabbath. It says that you cannot eat this on the Sabbath. It says you cannot eat this anytime. And all of those laws and all of those rules and all of those demands were a heavy burden. Not to mention what the Romans put on them at the time. People who had lots of money, people who had position, did not feel that oppression nearly so much. And so Jesus says, come to me, you who are needy, you who know what it's like to feel weighed down, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. The idea of having a yoke around your shoulders. Everybody know what a yoke is? Pretty much. In the olden days, they put yokes around people to carry buckets of water. They put yokes around oxen so that they could pull. It was a way of not only controlling the person or animal, but also allowing the weight of whatever it was to be a little bit more distributed, either across the front of the animal or across shoulders. I don't like the idea of having a yoke on me. But as I read more and looked at this, Jesus says, take my yoke. And I'm wondering if he is kind of referring to a double yoke, where I've got one half of it and Jesus has the other half. Imagine being yoked like that to Jesus and having Jesus walking step by step with you and step by step carrying whatever it is that you are burdened with. Or imagine too, if we are yoked to Jesus and learning from Jesus, we're not yoked to other things. Sometimes I think we yoke ourselves and carry burdens that we don't need to carry. Sometimes we carry a burden of, for those of us who are homeowners, sometimes having a house is a burden, particularly when things go wrong, when you're making mortgage payments, when you're making insurance payments, and then a tree falls down. And we yoke ourselves with things. Or we yoke ourselves and weigh ourselves down with credit card debt, maybe. Or we yoke ourselves by trying to meet the expectations of other people. We yoke ourselves to many things or many ideas or concepts that we don't need to carry. And Jesus says, take my yoke upon you, for I am gentle and humble in heart, not like the religious muckety-mucks who put heavy burdens on you. Jesus says, my burden is light. My yoke is easy. And as we learn from Jesus, we realize that Jesus' yoke and Jesus' burden is one of sharing God's love. It's one of helping out other people who may be struggling. It's a yoke of compassion and caring and loving. And Jesus says, learn from me, for I am gentle and here's the invitation for today. The invitation is to set aside the burdens that weigh you down. Let yourself be yoked to Jesus and help share his burden of compassion and caring that gives life not only to others, but to you and to me. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. Doesn't that sound good? Rest for our souls. In this quiet moment, think, please, of the things that burden you. And think about walking side by side with Jesus, sharing his yoke.
Amen.
might become even better stewards and caretakers of all creation. We thank you for the rain that waters the earth. We also pray for those who have had too much rain, who are dealing with flooded homes. We pray for those who have not had enough rain and who are fleeing wildfires or trying to put their lives back together. Lord, wherever we can, be your hands of blessing to those who are in need. We ask that you would guide us to do so. Lord, in your mercy.
Thank you.
Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Please share and read of God's peace. Life to those entombed by death, the way for self-giving love, for your word of life, O God.
We give you thanks and praise.
Send your spirit of truth, O God. Rekindle your gifts within us. Renew our faith, increase our hope, and deepen our love for the sake of a world in need. Faithful to your word, O God, draw near to all who call on you. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory forever.
Amen.
days, the Spirit sends us forth to serve.
Thanks be to God.